Our last video talked about some major configuration options when using the Cloud Talent Solution Job Search API. There are some simpler configuration options that we have recommendations for, and some best practices when testing out your API integration. Let's start with the configuration options when executing a search request against the API. First up, page size is a pretty simple one. It's the number of jobs that get returned in a single response. We typically recommend sticking to 20 or fewer to keep things quick. Now, if you're dealing with jobs in multiple geographic areas, you'll want to make sure that you set the region code through location filters and language code for each search. The search's region code will match the job's region code only to display results in the right regions. For example, if a region code isn't set, a search for Cambridge might return job results from Cambridge in the UK and Cambridge in the US. The language code will help the API localize the search query to increase the relevance of results through language-specific terminology. Not only can you set the region for searching, you can also set a distance in miles. Setting the distance to 50 would limit the search results returned to only be within 50 miles of the user's indicated address or a lat long. Like most of the configuration options, you should tweak this to what works best for your use case or expose an option to the user. The fewer restrictions you place on the query results, the more results you'll get, but potentially with less relevancy. There are also some configuration options you can set on individual job postings to help the API when searching, such as the location we just mentioned. When setting the location of a job, you should provide the address of the job, if possible, rather than the GPS coordinate. We'll go over more details in future videos when we talk about creating jobs in detail, but the API uses addresses to help with location detection and accurate results. In general, making sure jobs have locations helps users have a better experience when searching. For each job, you can also set an expiration time. After that time, the job no longer appears in results when performing a search. By default, the expiration time is 30 days after the job is created in the UTC time zone, but you can change the value for each job as necessary. Again, we recommend making sure to set this property to what makes the most sense for you and your users. There's also an employment type to help make sure users have more choice about what types of jobs are returned. Typical values can include full-time or part-time, but there are a number of options to help narrow down what can be returned, and not all options may be applicable to you. Finally, there's the custom attributes property. This allows you to add additional values to each job so that you can filter by them as needed, or to use with custom ranking like we talked about in the last video. For example, you may want to filter by GPA required or industry type. Now, we don't recommend setting up any custom attributes for location-based properties. That's because the API already has location logic specific to the location field on a job that we've already touched a bit on. With those configuration options in mind, you'll have a way to better control what jobs get returned for a search. There are also some best practices when designing your integration with the API that are worth noting. Make sure you do your best to avoid uploading duplicate jobs. While the API has protection to make sure nearly identical jobs don't show up next to each other, it's still a poor user experience to see the same job listing multiple times. When creating a job in the API, it automatically gets rejected if it's not unique according to a few parameters. Two jobs can't share the same combination of company, requisition ID, and location. Again, we'll look more at these when we go over creating jobs, but make sure to avoid any job duplicates before trying to create them in the API. Speaking of errors, you'll also want to make sure you've set up your integration to have appropriate error handling. When running any requests, make sure to check for the error codes in case the request didn't go through. Some common errors we've seen are cases where the job location is set incorrectly when uploading a job, or when required fields aren't set. You can check out the full list of all response codes in the link below. When debugging or investigating an error, we recommend starting with your local logging sources. You can then check out the Cloud Talent Solution Management tool to see what may have happened. It's also possible to set up Stackdriver to collect all the metadata, metrics, and events that you'll need to debug. If the error code is related to quota or sending too many requests, you may need to check the Cloud Talent Solution console, which you can access through the Google Cloud console for any indexing restrictions. It's good to know if you'll be limited on the number of jobs you can index at any given time before you upload any jobs and to prepare accordingly. When handling an actual error, we also recommend doing exponential backoff for any retries. There's another link in the description for this, but the basic idea is to ensure you design your system in a way that doesn't just spam the API with requests after a failure. These are some high-level things to keep in mind as you look to start integrating your jobs and data with the Job Search API. In our next video, we'll walk through the details of data that gets sent to the API, such as jobs and companies. Thanks for watching, and remember, when looking for talent, it's okay to keep your head in the cloud.